Boom. Before the video starts, I need to go over a couple things with you. One, the IRS has created a brand new portal for gig economy workers. I'm going to put the link down below, but they answer a lot of questions that you may have, whether before or after this video. Two, all of the links from the publications that I use to make this video will also be in the link down below. And three, I am not a tax consultant or a certified tax preparer. And if you have questions about your taxes, you should consult a professional. Let's go. Riding through my city with
that daddy bag. Thank you, Bentley.
What up, it's your boy Bentley Coop, DoorDash Diaries T3D, the one-stop shop for tips, tricks, and strategies to help you dominate with DoorDash. The end of the year is approaching, and that means the beginning of tax season. And if you have not started to track certain things, now is the time. In this video, I'm just going to give you a general overview of what to expect during tax season and a couple of different things that you need to start tracking right now. So who exactly needs to file taxes? The federal government says that anyone that made over $400 from the gig economy needs to file taxes. And if you have another source of income and made less than $400, you will have to count the income that you made from the gig economy in with your other income. So how long should we keep the record? The IRS again says that you should keep your records from 3 years from the time of filing. But I swear that it used to be something like 7. And to be completely honest with you, I'm gonna keep them for as long as possible. I personally would rather be safe than sorry. And the way that I'm gonna show you to save your information is pretty easy. It's kind of a one and done, so it won't be that big of a hassle. So where do we keep the information? Okay, so this is actually like a two-step process, but step one is we want to create an email address that is solely for our food delivery business. And then step two is we want to create a Dropbox with that email address specifically for the information that we're going to send in regards to our delivery business. So any receipts from maybe tolls, taxes, or any type of maintenance work that you're getting done. If you are applying for a car or house, this may be a great place to put your proof of income. But either way, anything that we scan or anything that we send off, including our tax forms, we're going to keep an extra copy here. And if you're a little wary about Dropbox, then you can always use the email address, email it to yourself so that you have a copy. So when do you actually pay your taxes? Again, according to the federal government, self-employed taxes are pretty much pay to play. So by the end of the year, you should have the majority of your tax obligations paid for. And there's a form, Schedule 1040 ES, which will allow you to estimate your taxes. But this is like a physical form. This isn't something where you can punch in the information online and it'll give it to you. This is old school. You have to go through pen and paper and add it up. So that may not be the best way. And I'm trying to find another way for us to estimate our taxes. And as soon as I do, as usual, I'll get that to you. Tracking miles. If you are not going to claim the standard mile deduction, then there may be situations where you have to give the work percentage of your vehicle. In order to do this, you're going to have to use miles. And because of that, it's not only important to track your business miles, but your actual personal miles as well. Mileage is a really big topic and one that I get questions about a lot. One question that I get in particular is, what can I do if I'm not tracking my miles at all? At the end of the year, you can still claim the standard, just regular deduction as if you were a single, joint, or head of household instead of trying to itemize your deduction. Sticking with the miles, the IRS says that if you do not have a home office or business locale, then in 2020, you cannot count the miles from your home to your first restaurant and from your last restaurant to your home. Again, this is a gray area, and I know there has been a lot of different information. I myself have even calculated this a different way up until this point. But with this being said, I'm definitely going to fall in line with how I need to track it. We're going to take the standard mileage deduction, and because of this, we need to track our miles. But you could take the actual expenses of what it costs you to operate during the year, and this is a list of expenses that you could actually deduct. You have the ability to take whichever one is higher, the standard mileage deduction or your actual expenses. And there again, if you're having trouble or maybe late to the game and have not tracked your miles with accuracy, you could still take just the general standard deduction at the end of the year. Your phone bill. If you have one phone that you use for both personal and business, you won't be able to deduct the full amount of your phone bill for the year. You will have to base what you deduct off of how you use the phone for business. The same would go for a mobile device that has some type of data package attached to it, something like a tablet that you use solely for GPS in your car. Meals. In 2020, meals cannot be deducted during regular working hours. If you are out of town and you are working more than you are playing, that would be the only situation where you could deduct meals. So you're driving around in your normal city during Monday through Friday, regular business hours. The food that you buy is not tax deductible. But if you take a trip 4 hours away from your home base in order to work, then the meals that you pay for while you are out of town would actually be tax deductible. Subscriptions. This is more for my ride sharers and not necessarily for my food delivery people, but any type of subscriptions that you have that directly relate to the business are actually tax deductible. And the two things that jump out to me the most, number one is Spotify, and then number two is going to be any type of car wash subscription that you have where you wash your car, vacuum out your car before you start your day of service. Last but not least is going to be business insurance. I already talked about this one in a previous video, but if you carry business insurance on your vehicle, the total premium of your business insurance is going to be tax deductible. Boom. So there it is, giving you a general overview of who needs to file, when you need to file, and pretty much everything that you need to start tracking right now. If you're going to do this full time or if you anticipate doing this for the long haul, I would suggest that you go ahead and try to create some type of system that allows you to track a lot of this stuff automatically, or sit down once or twice a month to just go ahead and just get everything synced up. Bentley Coupe, Dirt Dash Diaries, T3D. We love them.